Yeah, that's my introduction. I like to dance, but I didn't always get to do it in church. Y'all didn't realize you called a preacher that dances, do you? I withheld that, didn't I? Choir, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you for stirring our hearts and preparing us for the worship around God's Word. Brother Scott, I think it was in the 70s, and I'm dating you, and I'm with you. I believe it was in the 70s that there was this parquet commercial. I think it was parquet, butter, you know, that the lady, a well-known actress, she would sit there with this real serious tone, and she would say, "It's not nice to fool with Mother Nature." Y'all remember that? If you're under 30, you may not remember that, but for everyone else, I've just totally lost the younger generation with that commercial. But anyway, you know, we live in a day and age that wants to worship creation rather than the Creator. And in our modern society, they want to take our eyes off of what God created and the roles of which God created and place them upon some mystical forms of worship. Worship the creation. I love trees. But I don't want to hug one as an act of worship. I love what man, in God-like inspiration, can make out of wood and not worship the wood itself, but worship the image, the God of the image. And so I want us to turn today and look at a familiar passage. I mean, this passage has been preached so many different ways down through millennia. And I can't imagine there being much better way to preach it than to just simply open it and read it, and it will certainly make sense to all of us as we do that. Looking at Proverbs chapter 31. Now, two things happen when we read this passage. One, men are saying, "Yes, honey, you really need to look at this one. You need to read this one." I'm just like telling you, baby, you need to look at it. Men, our day is coming. Okay, our day is coming. And so whatever we want to look at the wife and say, this is how you should be, our day is coming too. Our responsibilities are coming. This is God's ideal. It doesn't mean that we all measure up to this. His word just simply has a standard of which we aspire to. This side of heaven, we're not going to be perfect. This side of heaven, we're not going to be completely to the standard of God. But this is the idea. This is the standard of which we encourage all young ladies who grow and have children as they grow and mature in the Lord. We give this as an act of encouragement. I won't ask you to stand necessarily because I would like to read verses 1 through 31. So in honor of God's word, if you would please stand. If you would, go ahead and stand. If you need to sit down in the middle of this, feel free to do so. Verse 31, chapter 31, beginning reading with verse 1. The words of King Lemuel, the utterances which his mother taught him. "What, my son? And what, son of my womb? And what, son of my vows? Do not give your strength to women, nor your ways to that which destroy kings. It is not for kings, O Lemuel, it is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princesses intoxicating drink, lest they drink and forget the law, and pervert the justice of all the afflicted. Give strong drink to him who is perishing, and wine to those who are bitter of heart. Let him drink and forget his poverty, and remember his misery no more. Verse 8, open your mouth for the speechless, and the cause of all who are appointed to die. Open your mouth, judge righteously, and plead the cause of the poor and the needy. Verse 10, who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her, so will have no lack of gain. She does good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flask and willingly works with her hands. She is like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and portion for her maidservants. She considers a field and buys it. From her profits, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and strengthens her arms. Verse 18, she perceives that her merchandise is good and her lamp does not go out by night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hand holds the spindle and extends her hand to the poor. Yes, she reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household is clothed with scarlet. She makes tapestry for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them, and supplies sashes for the merchandise, for the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing. She finds rejoice. She shall rejoice in time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you exceed them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. You may be seated. May we pray. Our Father, we come before you, and Lord, we see these passages, and Lord, we see them in our mothers, faithful, godly women who labored, many of which have, and some maybe are, fulfilling this role all by themselves, with children at their side. And our hearts goes out to women who nurture the young, who instruct the old, who encourage the needy, who build up the body of the saints, who then, Lord, in various times and seasons in their life, they bring glory to your name. We thank you for our mothers. We thank you for those, Lord, that have gone on to glory. Many of our hearts are weary today because our hearts are filled with precious memories. A warm meal that was prepared in an early morning. A favorite dish. A kind word on a difficult day. A smile when discouragement had come in. A rock in a cradle of maybe which we do not remember or recall. But nevertheless, our emotions are filled by her faithfulness. May your word speak truth. May your word be encouragement. May your word lift us up and bring glory to your name. And as always, Lord Jesus, may it advance on every front, and may your word never suffer loss. And this we pray in the precious name of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Now, typically we start the passage at verse 10, but there's something interesting about the verses 1 through 9. And what we find here, we don't know who King Lemuel is. Some have suggested that it was Solomon, which would have made his mother Bathsheba. Kind of an interesting situation. She would have known, certainly, this passage. And God worked mightily in her heart. And what we find is in those first 9 verses, she is seeking to take this young man, who is a princess, who is going to be king. And one of the most profound things that we find is that she is a teacher. A faithful, godly mother is a teacher. And notice what she says regarding being a teacher. Two things that she brings out that she teaches this young prince who's going to be a king, who's going to rule over a land, that's going to rule over people. What does she teach him? Two important facts. Stay away from bad women and strong drink. He didn't say stay away from women. The encouragement there, the sense of the passage is stay away from bad women and strong drink. Now the point of her teaching these principles is that it takes his mind and attention away from being a godly husband, ruler, leader. She recognizes that there's two things in life that can totally take our attention. I say this is a passage that as much is to men as it is to women, because her instruction is to men. Stay away from the things that make you weak. And that is a lesson today, men. We know our weaknesses. This mother knew the weaknesses of every man. And she knew the weakness of a young man that was going to be, had much power, wealth, and control. And so a faithful mom is a teacher. I want to give you something that's a little bit encouraging, and maybe we have found our mothers teach us, or at times, it's the way we hear and remember our mothers teaching us on everyday humorous levels. My mother taught me to appreciate a job well done. This is her quote. If you're going to kill each other, do it outside. I just finished cleaning. I remember that one. My mother taught me about religion. You better pray that will come out of the carpet. My mother taught me about time travel. If you don't straighten up, I'm going to knock you into the middle of next week. My mother taught me about logic. Because I said so, that's why. My mother taught me about foresight. Make sure you wear clean underwear in case you're in an accident. Are you really going to care at that time? My mother taught me irony. Keep crying and I'll give you something to cry about. My mother taught me about the science of osmosis. Shut your mouth and eat your supper. Laughter means we've heard it, right? My mother taught me about stamina. You sit there until all that spinach is gone. I've said this one. My mother taught me about weather. This room of yours looks as if a tornado went through it. My mother taught me about behavior modification. Stop acting like your father. My mother taught me about envy. Oh, this is a good one. There are millions of less fortunate children in the world who do not have wonderful parents like you do. My mother taught me about anticipation. Just wait until we get home. My mother taught me about receiving. You are going to get it when you get home. My mother taught me medical science. If you don't stop crossing your eyes, the wind will change and you will stay like that. My mother taught me how to become an adult. If you don't eat your vegetables, you'll never grow up. A couple more. My mother taught me genetics. You act just like your father. My mother taught me about my roots. Shut the door behind you. Do you think you were born in a barn? I know some folks that were born in barns. My mother taught me wisdom. When you get my age, you'll understand. My mother taught me about justice. One day you'll have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you. All right, so our mothers have certainly taught us in times of difficulty and strain, they've taught us a few things. All right, the next thing we're going to see in verses 10 through 11, look at 10 and 11. Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts in her. All right, she is trustworthy. A noble wife, a faithful wife, a godly wife is trustworthy. Now, this was put in there. Notice the passage in it says that he safely trusts in her. He will like no gain. She does him good, not evil, all the days of her life. This passage, when you put it into context, means everything. Because in the ancient world, women were held at such a low esteem at that point in time that men, it was known that men, certainly those of wealth, would hide their riches or their money bag. They would either take as much as they could or they would hide it because they had this perpetual fear that their wife, who they had little regard for in that time, would take all of their wealth, steal it, and go and spend it on men or some other kind of fancy item or clothing item. This is put in here because a godly mother was understood that her husband could go anywhere around the world and that his wealth would be increased, his life would be increased by his departure than as much as it was if he was there. It was understood that a wonderful, godly mother could take the little and make it much. Have we not seen that? I've seen my grandmother take a little bit of flour and then somehow or another make 22 biscuits out of it. I've seen my grandmother and my own mother take a little and make much. Ladies, thank you. Thank you for being so trustworthy, dependable, taking whatever we have as men and extending it far above and beyond that we could ever make it. She's trustworthy. And then she is wise. Verse 26. Skip down and look at verse 26. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She is wise. She is wise beyond her years. And when her years are extended, she has real wisdom. She learns from that wisdom. I want to turn over to Titus chapter 2. You don't necessarily have to turn there, but I'm going to turn over there and read that. Titus chapter 2. In the New Testament, the Apostle Paul is teaching Titus, as it relates to the church, different roles of men and women in the church and of parents. He's giving them instruction. This is what he says to say regarding women in Titus chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. But as for you, speak the things which are proper for sound doctrine, that the older men be sober, there it comes again, reverent, temperate, sound in faith, in love and patience. The older women likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not slanderers, not given much wine, teachers of good things, that they admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, homemakers, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be blasphemed. We're living in a day and age where the world is dependent on looking for leaders. We're living in a leadership void world. And the world is looking for some kind of example of which to turn to. It longs for it. The only examples they have are those that are given to through social media and the internet. And brothers and sisters, the church must hold that standard. No one else is going to. The church, husbands and wives, leading and loving their home in a way of which is an example to the world by which they can turn and see. I don't believe where we're going to change the world by something any better. No new invention is going to change the world. Nothing that man can bring to this earth is going to change the world. Let me tell you what is going to change the world. It's going to be godly men and women having a godly example, raising children as difficult as it is in a polluted world, but doing everything they can to have their children in church. One of the wisest things that any mother can ever do is to make sure their children is in church. Now let me share this with you. I have noticed it, and statistics has played it out, that when women go to church, certainly their children will follow. And sometimes it's very hard for that dad to follow. Matter of fact, sometimes they resist it. But the mother lovingly and carefully takes their child to church. But something else, the statistics, and I've noticed, plays out, that when that dad takes those children to church, that wife will soon follow. Now, that doesn't play out in every scenario. But it seems as though the wife is greatly influenced by a godly man, that she will rise to the occasion, and she will be led by a father, even if she's not a believer. I've noticed it. When that godly man really gets on fire for the Lord and really decides to make leadership in his home, to take his family to church and to have them there as much as possible, I've seen that lady, whether she's a believer or not, will begin to get involved. It's not a rule. Doesn't happen in every case. It's certainly played out. And so the passage is as much for men as much as it is for women. The passage tells us not only how to be a good lady, it tells us the importance of having a good home. Homes are not perfect. Many of you probably came maybe from a perfect home. But the best home this side of heaven is still going to be short of God's standard. Don't let that ever discourage you. God, in His grace, can turn any home, can heal any marriage, can strengthen every woman, can fill any void heart, can do anything that this world can't do. God and His Word is able to come into a home and heal it regardless of what has come in between. I can't, but you know what? God can. He desires it. And we can do it by His grace and for His glory. Only His grace can do it. So thank the Lord for godly women who's held a standard. She is wise. We see that. Then we see she is praiseworthy. Verse 28. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Men, let's don't wait till one day of the year to praise our mothers, our wives. Let's don't wait till one day of the year. Let's praise her. I want to read to you a quote from Thomas Edison. He's the great inventor. This is what he had to say regarding his mother. Thomas Edison once said, "I did not have my mother long, but she cast over me an influence which has lasted all my life. The good effects of her early training I can never lose. If it had not been for her appreciation and her faith in me at a critical time in my experience, I should never likely have become an inventor. I was always a careless boy, and with a mother of different mental caliber, I should have turned out badly. But her firmness, her sweetness, her goodness were potent powers to keep me in the right path. My mother was the making of me. The memory of her will always be a blessing to me." That's the heart of a mother. You know, we honor our mothers even after they've gone on to glory. This time of the year is Memorial Sundays. I know my parents, they're at the grave of their parents, laying down, cleaning up the grave, making sure that it's just right. And yours is certainly the same. Thank God for your mother. Let me say this, and I say this with a sincere heart. Some of you may have not had a good mother, but that's the reality. You say, "Well, Brother Greg, how in the world can I praise a mother when she was not there for me? Maybe she was a non-believer," whatever the case was. And Mother's Day can be really hard, as well as Father's Day for some. You say, "Well, what do I do with that hurt and that pain?" Thank God for His grace and His sufficiency and His power in your life to overcome whatever has been in your past. Pray that God will one day show you, "God, I don't know why I had my mother for a short period of time. God, I don't know why I had the mother that I had. I wish I would have had a better mother or a godly mother. God allows everything in our life for a reason." You know, that's a cliche, and we say it all the time, but it's really true. It is very true. And regardless of our memories of our mother, whether they be good, great, wonderful, or very painful, use this as a day, as a marker in your life, to just say, "God, I don't know why the way I grew up was the way You allowed. I don't know why that I had those experiences and went through those things where I didn't have my mother long, or I didn't have the one I would have hoped for. I didn't have the mother like the kids in the classroom or the one next door. Or I don't understand why my parents lost their marriage when I was 10 years old or 12 years old at a critical point in my life. I don't know why those things happen, but brother and sister, I can tell you that His grace is sufficient in every circumstance. He can heal. He can move in our life. He can do the things that man can never soothe or heal. I think one of the most difficult times in times like this is those that are dealing with a broken heart. Christmas is a very difficult time for many. Other times such as this can be a very difficult time. Your wonderful mother may have already gone on to glory. Take a day like this and praise the Lord for whatever it was. It's hard. I know it's hard. I may not personally know your grief and pain. I may not personally be able to say I've walked your road. But I can say this, that His grace is sufficient, what? In our weakness. And in your weak memory. And in the times of your weak memory, give it over to the Lord. Give that pain, give that hardship. And that means what? Thank the Lord, praise Him maybe for a wonderful wife. Say, Father, I didn't have a wonderful mother, but thank You for giving me a godly wife that is turning back time and taking back which the locusts have taken to give me a wonderful wife that is raising our children under the grace, knowledge, and admonition of the Lord. And young people, let me say this. Look at this standard when you go to choose a young lady. Young ladies, look at this and you say, there is no way. I've got to sleep sometimes. I mean, look at this passage. This woman never slept. I mean, she didn't do any. I mean, she. When did she go to bed? The passage is just so full of this high standard. You look at it and you say, when did she eat? When did she sleep? She worked day and night. So we look at this and we think, wow, how in the world can you do it? Yes, it's lofty. Yes, it's high. But that doesn't mean we don't pray to meet a high standard. He's a high God with high morals and high principles. But it doesn't mean that we turn them aside because we can't always meet them. We don't just throw the Bible away and say, well, I can't do that. No one ever could. That's what's so beautiful about the grace of God. Folks, I am going to preach that to the day I pray I die. Where the law was weak, grace was strong. The law of God was up there, and the law of God, man looked at the law of God and said, God, I can't do it. I can't make that high leap. But the grace of God came down and said, no, you can't. You can't be that mother. You can't be that dad. You can't be that child. You can't do it. So where the law was weak, grace became strong, but only through Jesus Christ. You're struggling in your marriage. Women, you're struggling meeting this standard. Ladies, there is an empty cradle. Your children have gone on and they've moved on and they're all over the world and maybe they couldn't be with you today. Some may be wayward. I would suspect in a crowd this size, there's a mother whose heart is grieving because there is a wayward child. There is no other time, no other grief than a mother that is concerned about the wayward child. I know you're praying. I know you're fasting. I know you're working. But don't, no matter what the wayward child is, no matter what the condition of the child is, commit that child into the Lordship of Jesus Christ and don't stop praying. Don't stop the night and day praying. Don't stop fasting. And guess what? Get your church praying for your children. That's what we're all about. That's why we're here. Get that Sunday school. Get that prayer partner. Don't carry your burdens of your children alone. Don't carry them alone. That's what we're meant. That's why we're here. We have forgotten the beauty of the church. We've lost its glory. Christ died for it. And there's coming a day that He is going to return out of the eastern sky, and the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ are going to rise first, And there we will be and meet him in the air, and time will be no more. I can't wait for the day when the church is no longer suffering under the weight of the problems and the pressures of a current day. I can't wait for that trumpet to sound. I can't wait when the church is called up, no longer under the afflictions they were in, no longer looking at passages and saying, God, I can't meet it. No longer being burdened by all the things that we have. There's coming a time when certainly time is not going to be anymore. And we will rest at his side and we will feed at his table. Regardless, precious mother, your heart may be heavy. Empty nest, wayward child. Child you hope will go and do right in college. A mother who hopes and prays that which they have taught, that which they have prayed, that which they have nurtured and cared for will continue into that day. And let me just share with you as we begin to close, how can we honor our mothers, whether they've passed or whether they're here? How do we honor a mother? We can certainly tell her and give her a card. But I say this as young people, and I say this for all of us. The best way we can honor our mother is to do right. The best way. You want to honor your mother in times of temptation, in times of weakness, in times of despair, in times when everything doesn't make sense, in times when you want to move to the right or to the left. Stay firm, unmovable, unshakable. Go back to the teachings of your mother. Go back to the Word. Don't move away from the church. Don't move away from the Scripture. Stay firm in the faith. Do right. Do right. That's the best way you can honor your mother, is do right and never stop. Let it be a firm foundation for you. And then lastly, she is timeless. Timeless. Verses 29 through 31. Many daughters have done well, but you exceed them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Doesn't matter what's on the outside. Doesn't matter what the world says she has or doesn't have. Precious mothers, your precious hand that rocked the cradle, that held on to that hand when they crossed the street, who fixed the bottles, who changed the diapers, who prepared the meal, who washed the clothes, who went and picked you up from school, who risked her own life in many cases to have you, that is a timeless lady. One godly mother can change the destiny of a home, of a family, of a people, of a nation, and of a world. Just one. Ladies, we thank you. We thank you. Never forget that, yes, we love you. We thank you. We praise God for you. May God be with us in our homes. May God be with us with our children. And may God be with us in the days of come. May we pray. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, that the world is not our mother. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we don't worship Mother Nature. We thank you that this passage truly is the world of a godly mother. I pray, dear Father, that whatever circumstances that a mother may be here today, whatever may be upon her heart, whatever may be heavy upon her mind, whatever may be going on at every home and every family, we're living in a very difficult time. Circumstances and issues and situations may not be as they were many years ago. Lord, this is a new day, a new time, and a new age, a new generation. The world has changed. But Lord God, we don't worship the world. We worship the God who created the world. We worship the God of the universe, the God of the yesterday, the God of today, and the God of forever. Father, we come and we bring you every issue, every circumstance, every home, every parent and every child, every marriage. Lord, we surrender them unto you. We thank you that you, through your Son, affirm the role of a mother. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you love the role of motherhood. You love the role of women, godly women in our life, who make us as men better, stronger, more able to do great things. We thank you, dear Father, that what they do has eternal impact. Their role is timeless. She's a teacher. Thank you, Father, that she's trustworthy. Thank you that she is wise. Thank you, Father, that she's praiseworthy. Thank you, Lord, that she knows no time, that what she does right here extends to the farthest extents of the universe. And so, Father, we come today to worship your name, to gather around your word, and to rub shoulders with one another so that we too might have a body that is built up in the name of Christ. Thank you, Lord. I pray over every home and every mother. Thank you for their hard work. Thank you for the blessings that you've given us through them. In this we pray in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, if you would please stand and let this be a time that you respond as the Lord leads. You may want to bring your home or your concerns or your decision, no matter what it is, to the altar of the Lord. May we stand.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and live. world affords today.
All right, we have a brother and a sister coming today. And we have Cameron Griffith. Cameron, come on up. And your sister?
Carson.
Carson, okay. They're twins. That's right. That's exactly right. Well, y'all are near and dear to my heart. Twins, one couldn't join, and then the other joined. So, yeah, you got to stay together. Now, are y'all able to read each other's mind like everybody? No. Everybody thinks twins can just, you know, they read their minds or whatever, but no, this is such a good day. This is your new home. They've come today by statement of faith. Is that right? Okay. You've been baptized. All right. Amen. So they come from a sister church here in town, and they have come to transfer their letter and let you know that they'd like for you to be their new church family. Amen. Exactly. Thank you. If it be good with you, and you've already affirmed that, do it one more time. Welcome them as your new church family. Amen. I'm going to take that as a yes, and any no's, I hope not. You are here. You are here. This is now your church home and your church family. We rejoice. Rejoice. Yes, please. I'd like for y'all to stand out front with me, and everyone can have an opportunity to greet you right here at the end of the service. Let's have a word of prayer before the ushers come forward. Father, I thank you for this brother and sister. I thank you, dear Lord, that they have now made the decision to become a part of this church home and this church family. Lord, we have now agreed to take the high and lofty responsibility for these two young people to show them an example of what a godly church looks like. Lord, we don't take that lightly. That's our role. Every word, every thought, every action, and every deed is to build these two young people up in the name of the Lord and to one day to send them forth to do mighty things for you. We pray all of these blessings of power, grace, mercy, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Y'all go forward with us.
Ushers, let me ask you to come on and receive this morning's offering. We do come to this high point of worship in our service today. As we have received, we pray that we would return a portion of that which God has blessed us with. Thank you for being here today. Let me just make one quick announcement. We've been announcing for the last couple of weeks that our guitarist, Chris Stone, is going to be away on a mission this coming summer. And today's the last day you can buy T-shirts as a support for him. You can still give to him for the next few weeks. But today's the last day if you want to support him by buying one of the T-shirts that he's selling to raise his funds. You can do that today, and you need to see Chris. Chris, stand up for us and just make sure everybody sees you. And so if you would see Chris, or you can still continue to give a designated gift toward his mission trip for this summer. We do pray God's rich blessings on you. Happy Mother's Day to you. We pray that you have a great afternoon, and enjoy the afternoon with your mom if you can. If you can't, enjoy the opportunity to be home with your family, and we pray God's blessings on you. God bless.
Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart.